Hey guys, it's Sebastian from AskSebby, and today we're going to do a roundup of a bunch of different topics. Big favor before we dive into all of this is to give this a thumbs up, and if you know anyone else who'd benefit, then share this with them. Starting off, I shared a bunch of Amazon Prime Day deals over on Instagram, so if you're not following us over there, then go check that out. If you're a time traveler watching this in the future, then maybe skim past this area. I'll put a little timestamp to jump to. Running through some Amazon stuff, if you are someone that has a Citi card and you have thank you points, you're going to get $20 off by spending $50 and using at least one thank you point. Optimal strategy is to only use one point, and I'll link that down below in the description box. So for example, here is me adding the offer and seeing the $20 discount. If you use code GCPRIME21, when you spend $40 on gift cards, you're going to end up getting a $10 statement credit in 2 business days. I believe this is only for Prime members, but I think it's worth that 10-second check. If you're looking for new headphones, the Bose 700s are almost 50% off. Retail is about $400, and right now, it's about $230. Last one is if you want a 2020 iPad Air, then you can get $100 off. I would probably wait for the refresh because I feel like it's coming compared to other products. So when you think of Bose, their product cycles are a lot longer. Apple's pretty fast. If you're interested, I'll leave a link down below, and we have a few other highlighted ones on our blog post, AskSebby, and also on Instagram, AskSebby. The last one is going to be Rakuten, which has a bunch of 10x offers. Pretty sure they're playing off the marketing of this week as well, and there's even some that are higher. Nike, Adidas, as well as Uniqlo popped out to me given where I shop. If you're making a big purchase, then Dyson and Samsung might be interesting as well, but be careful with those ones because there's oftentimes exclusions. If you're someone new to Rakuten, then you can get $30 by opening an account and spending $30 in purchases. So this does have to be within the first 90 days, but pretty much a no-brainer. Link down below if you want to check it out. And for people watching today on Prime Day still, let me know what you ended up buying because I'm generally curious. I'm probably just buying more office stuff. Gonna say goodbye to you guys while we jump to the time travelers. Moving into the first major topic, we have Amazon looking to break up with Chase. This is pretty substantial because a lot of you guys are fans of Amazon and probably have that card. I feel like if things were going well, then we wouldn't hear about Amazon shopping offers. As a background, Chase currently has the rights to the Prime Rewards card and also the rewards one, so the normal non-Prime card. Chase's main competition does the business cards, while Synchrony does the store cards, so I'm guessing this is the financing type ones, the longer term ones, and also the secured cards. This is actually pretty substantial because Chase and Amazon have been working together since 2002, so that's almost 20 years. The fact that Amazon added a new issuer for business cards is pretty concerning, and I think a lot of people thought something was brewing. When you think about banks, they're interested in two things: collecting interest and also transaction fees. Both of the Chase cards together account for $15 billion in loans. Together, they account for $50 billion in transactions every year. My understanding is that Amazon ends up either getting a cut of it, or they're paid a royalty or some other agreement because they're using the branding. Amazon's definitely not letting them use this for free. So the crazy thing to me is that Chase is apparently willing to let Amazon walk away. My guess, and this is just a prediction because maybe they don't even break up, is one, that Amazon does not tie into Chase's long-term plans in the next 5 to 10 years. It just doesn't really fit. This wouldn't be too big of a surprise because Chase has been pretty aggressive in cross-selling products. So they want you to get Sapphire Banking. They want you to do brokerage stuff. They want you to have a savings checking account, all of your other stuff with them. I'm guessing the Amazon audience did not convert over in the way that they wanted. Chase has also been a bit more travel focused, and maybe the cashback from the Amazon card just doesn't fit into this. I'll probably talk about this a bit more in a future video, but Chase is opening up their own series of lounges, Sapphire lounges, and I wouldn't be surprised if travel and the mid and upper tier cards are their main focus. The second potential reason might be that the portfolio didn't turn as much of a profit as they wanted, so maybe it did make money, but it barely broke even, and it's not hitting the marks that they're going for. But how's that possible? They have $15 billion in debt and also $50 billion in transactions. They must be turning a profit, right? So for Chase, with a lot of their other partners, they're not paying the full retail price for the points that they're giving out. So for United, Hyatt, and all those other partners, yes, they might be giving us points and we might be getting 6%, 7%, 10% in value, but that's not the average person. The average person who doesn't bother watching credit card YouTube videos, who's not looking to redeem points, they're probably just redeeming the points whenever they have the chance. And that's pretty much the goal of cash back. Nothing wrong with those people. And ironically, those are my parents. They see the opportunity to use points and not use cash, so they go for it. So the problem is pretty obvious. If you have a card that's paying you 5% cash back, that's hitting their bottom line. If it's 5x in points instead, though, maybe the points don't end up getting redeemed. Maybe they get redeemed at a bad rate. People forget about them, and also the fact that oftentimes they're buying points at a discount. For these airline and hotel groups, they're pretty much pre-selling seats for their future flights, and they don't have to worry about that. That's the future airline's problem. So to me, the big question is, what happens to your cards? If Chase ends up keeping the portfolio, my guess is that they end up negotiating something with Amazon in the back end and also putting a cap on the 5% back. So for the Amazon business card, it's 5% back on your first $120,000 in spend per calendar year. After that, it's only 1%. So would the personal card have something similar? Maybe it's only $25,000 in spend, and then anything beyond that, that's only 1%. The other thing too is that business cards earn the bank more money. Unsurprisingly, the fees for business cards end up being a little bit higher. There's definitely some small business people and also startup people who could probably spend $100,000 every quarter just because they have to buy inventory and stuff for their office. On the flip side, what if Chase sells it? So apparently they can get a pretty big premium on their portfolio, so I think they're going to go with that. JP Morgan can fetch a 15% premium selling the portfolio. To me, this actually makes the most sense because if you look online on the Amazon.com website, ironically, and look at the reviews for the Amazon card, the Prime card, you're going to see a lot of one-star reviews, and most people are angry about Chase. Basically, either Chase won't approve them or they did end up approving them but ended up closing their account afterwards. Another factor is that normies don't know what Chase 524 is. They're not really focused on stuff like that, and they're probably getting rejected for cards that they otherwise feel like they should be accepted for. My theory for all of this, and don't sue me, is that Chase is not very good at underwriting subprime. I feel like their underwriting is generally pretty risk adverse, and they're used to people who are prime who they want to become their long-term customers. Ironically, I think that's the use case for Synchrony buying the portfolio because subprime is their bread and butter. They'll probably end up jacking up interest rates and fees, but that doesn't really affect us for our purpose, given how we're using cards. I don't see them increasing annual fees or adding one to the card, so not too worried there. I do have two dark horse picks, but I don't think they're going to happen. The first one is Wells Fargo because they're looking to add to their portfolio and it seems like they're willing to pay. The second dark horse pick would be Goldman Sachs, and this might seem like a weird one, but remember that they did work with the Apple card. So is there a world where Goldman Sachs ends up making the Amazon card the new Apple card? Some of you are probably thinking that Apple is Apple, right? So they have such strong branding that they don't need marketing help, but if you remember, there was another Apple card before this, and that was by Barclays. So even though it existed and people used it, the reason it's not coming to mind is because it was mostly a financing card, and they didn't really do a good job of marketing it. I would actually argue that the Apple card is what it is due to Goldman Sachs' marketing. So is there a situation where they can do that for Amazon, and in that process, lower the cost? Right now, it's a pretty boring card that earns you 5% back on Amazon purchases if you have Prime, but what if they make it super cool? And then they knock the rates down to 2% and 3%. That's not great for us, but it's good for their bottom line, and I would argue that the normal person who thinks about credit cards, or I guess who doesn't think about them, cares more about how cool a card is rather than the earn rate. You'd be surprised how many people like to argue with me that the Apple card is the best card ever and that all the other cards are pretty much irrelevant. One final factor is Chase's recent investment in the Chase Sapphire Preferred. So that 100,000 point offer, that's marketing dollars that they're spending in order to build an audience and then to ideally put them into different products. That's pretty much them doing this to bring you into the store. It's a loss leader. It's pretty much what Walmart does. They put a very cheap product in the back. And also what Costco does, they put the $5 chicken in the back to make you walk through the whole store to look for other items in order to get that chicken. This seems pretty intentional and long-term thinking given the nature of banks, and I just don't see how the Amazon card would tie into this. My guess is that Chase ends up letting Amazon walk unless they can get a sweetheart deal on the back end that we probably won't see. What if you're someone who has the card? I'd pretty much just wait and see what happens. There's not really much you can do on your end. If they do sell their portfolio and for whatever reason you don't want to go to the new issuer, then you can probably cancel your card at that point, but I wouldn't do anything for now. But what if you're someone who doesn't have the card yet? Should you apply for it? So there's two arguments for this. The first one is, well, if they're going to go away, then you might as well get that intro bonus, technically a discount from an Amazon purchase. The other argument is that that's a 524 slot that you can use for a different card. So for example, if you're someone at 424, yes, you can apply for the Amazon card, but if it's being sold off to Synchrony later anyways, then you could technically apply for the Synchrony card. Instead, you could apply for the Freedom Flux, the Freedom Unlimited, and that's another intro bonus that you otherwise wouldn't have gotten while you're still getting the Amazon Prime intro bonus once it moves over. So hopefully that makes sense, two bonuses instead of one, depending on what happens. Maybe you end up going for the 100K Chase Sapphire Preferred that's technically worth $1,250 via Pay Yourself Back or for your summer trip. Even with the annual fee, that's only $1,155, so pretty good. And if you want to do a YOLO trip, you could probably get a lot more value, upwards of $2,000. On that note, if you want to learn about this card or pretty much any other card out there and you want to support the channel, we do have links on our website, AskSebby.com, and also down below in the description box. If you're considering the Chase Sapphire Preferred, I would strongly recommend running the numbers. We do have a calculator on that as well, just to make sure that you're actually getting value and that it makes sense. My question for you guys is, do you think Amazon is breaking up with Chase? And if they are, who are they going to go to? Let me know and everyone else know in the comments down below. If you'd like to, give it a thumbs up. If you know anyone else who benefit, then share this with them. Probably help them out, but otherwise, hope you guys liked it. See you guys next time. A little bit of an awkward wave, but I think it's still good.